Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Derek. Well, basically, yeah, the goal of my presentation is to focus on how we can measure greenhouse gas emissions at destination. Of course, it will be a very quick presentation. I don't have a lot of time, but basically my goal is to provide you some food for thought so that later on, no, in case you want to delve into some of these aspects, you can find a way to do that and you can find some sources. My name is Kepa Solao. I work for Factor CO2, which is an international consulting firm which specializes in climate change and sustainability. And I am also professor of environmental economics at the University of Navarra. So, yeah. When it comes to measuring climate change, well, there are two aspects. Because on the one hand, we know that our sector emit greenhouse gases and that this is causing, or this is one of the main causes of anthropogenic climate change. And this is what we'll be talking about, but I didn't want to forget about the other side of the equation, which Sergio just mentioned, which is that also we will be impacted by climate change. We know that, you know, temperature is changing. We know that we are experiencing sea level rise, rainfall patterns are changing, extreme weather events, etc. So this is another part of the equation that it's also very interesting to measure, and we can do that by using climate projections, which will help us, you know, with a lot of accuracy to know how climate is going to evolve in one particular area. We can use vulnerability assessments, both in terms of monetary terms, such as Sergio mentioned, or both using multi-criteria analysis. But today we will focus on the other part. We will be talking about emissions, and we will be talking about greenhouse gas inventories and carbon footprints. It's not exactly the same. I will elaborate a bit more on this, but basically the idea is we are measuring greenhouse gas emissions in both cases. The difference is that carbon footprint is a little bit broader, and we will try to cover not just direct emissions, but also all the emissions along the value chain of the sector. So, okay, here we are. There is a lot of information on this slide, sorry about that, but basically I wanted to start from the very basics to a little bit more technical details on how to calculate greenhouse gas emissions, and all that in 1 minute, okay? Just in case, very basic, greenhouse gas emissions are calculated, so we don't need to measure, we don't need to have technical devices, no analyzing the quality of the air in one specific destination. What we need to do basically is to obtain some activity data, for example, I don't know, energy consumption by cars, fluorinated gases used in air conditioning systems, things like that, and we multiply this activity data with emission factors. This is a little bit how it works. So it's not so much about measuring technical devices and stuff like that, it's more about having information. We can do that by using bottom-up or top-down approaches. There is not a very sharp distinction between bottom-up and top-down, but basically the difference, it depends mainly on data. Sometimes we have very specific information. For example, we know how many energy have some cars used by tourists in one area, how much energy they are consuming, and other times what we have is aggregated data at country level, regional level, and we need to disaggregate or we need to allocate how much of these emissions are due to tourism. So it depends on data, and both approaches are complementary. Okay? And also, if you have a look in literature, you will find that sometimes we use what we call destination approach and sometimes a resident approach. This is a little bit like the GDP and the GNP, the gross domestic product versus the gross national product. Most of the time we will focus on the destination, which is all the emissions that are that go to the atmosphere in one specific region, and we don't care whether these emissions are caused by our residents or whether they are caused by international travelers. We include everything here. Whereas if we use a resident approach, basically we focus on the emissions by our people, by our nationals. Okay, so we consider the emissions of our people here and when they travel abroad. So basically we'll be talking today about destination, but just for you to know that there are different approaches. Okay, and as I said, when it comes to the carbon footprint approach, the idea is to cover not just direct emissions in one specific area, but to cover all the value chain of the tourism industry. Which includes from travel agencies, transport, logging, food services, and even historical buildings, museums, all the energy and all the emissions that are necessary for that. This is why we talk about carbon footprint. Okay. There are several methodologies. You may find very specific methodologies, for example, for hotels or for air emissions and things like that. And we also have broader methodology that can be used, for example, in a city, and then you can allocate emissions for the sector. Okay. Basically, we talk about scopes, which means from the closest to the industry to the emissions that are a little bit more far away. Okay, and with direct emissions, we include from direct energy consumption, the energy that we use in buildings, for example, transportation on site, fluorinated gases that are used in air conditioning systems, or for example, waste generation and management, all the emissions related to that. When we talk about the scope two, this is the terminology of the sector, sorry about that, we talk about electricity, which means that even if we are not producing the electricity that we need, we are consuming electricity. And the production of this electricity elsewhere has produced emissions, and we need to account for that. So basically, we're including electricity consumption, including the electricity for transportation, specifically railways, okay, and today cars as well, of course. And when we talk about scope three, we are now focusing on other indirect emissions, which means that now we are focusing on the whole value chain, which means we would need to take into account international transportation. We will need to take into account food, beverage, travel agencies, and even some methodologies take into account capital goods and other combustion services. Of course, this is a work in progress. I mean, this is not something that you can do overnight and you have your full carbon footprint. This is something that you need to start doing and to improve over time. Okay? And I wanted to provide you with two examples of projects that my company has developed in calculating carbon footprints of, in this case, countries, of the tourism industry in countries. This is one example from Spain. Basically, this is not a carbon footprint approach. This is more a greenhouse gas inventory approach. So basically, we have what I called before scope one and scope two. Okay, with scope one emissions, we included all the energy consumptions in buildings, in restaurants, in vacation homes, etc. We took into account as well the transportation, all the fuel combustion in transport, maritime transportation, air transport, the waste management as well, the generation and management of waste produces greenhouse gas emissions and fluorinated gases. Okay, and we also took into account indirect consumption, in this case, electricity consumption, both for homes, services, etc., and also for railway transport. In this case, in this project, we didn't have bottom-up information, so it was a top-down approach, which means that we used the energy balance of the country, the greenhouse gas inventory of the country, and tourism satellite accounts. Okay, it was a top-down approach, as we said before. So out of all the emissions that you have in the country, you try to allocate emissions that are due to the tourism industry, which gives you an approach, which is good, more or less consistent with the GDP in this case, but it's just an approach. Okay, so this is like the first example. Okay. And the second that I wanted to mention is Montenegro. This is a project that we did in 2016 with information from 2015. This project or the report from this project is available online, so if you want to have a look, you can. And this was broader in terms that we covered the carbon footprint of the sector. Okay, we categorized the emissions as in-country emissions and off-country emissions, but we basically covered the full value chain of the sector, including accommodation and other services, all the fuel consumption, the same as in Spain. We use road transport, railway transport, not just fuel, but also electricity, airport transportation, cruises, mainly, and all sea transportation, also waste. Okay? And in this case, we use a hybrid approach, because for some of these services, we needed to use a top-down approach, but for others, we have very good bottom-up information, which is the best way to go, to use two sources of information so you can be sure about the magnitude, okay? And we also have off-country emissions, which were more important than in-country emissions, which included road transportation, railway, air transport, and cruises. And air transport and cruises were the most important sources of greenhouse gas emissions in this example. So this is why it is important not just to focus on scope one and scope two, but to try to cover the full spectrum. Of course, when you use a carbon footprint approach, you need to take into account that sometimes you are double counting, for example. No, and this scope three emissions for Montenegro can be a scope one emissions from another country. So you need to be careful about how you analyze these results. And of course, we are not talking about, we're not saying that these emissions, that Montenegro is to blame for these emissions. We are just trying to calculate and to provide the full picture of emissions, because once you have this information, when you can manage data. No? So this is basically what I wanted to say, just some conclusions. I already mentioned that calculating a greenhouse gas inventory or a carbon footprint is a process rather than a product. So don't think that just by having a figure, just by doing the calculations in 1 year, you will have the full picture. What is really important is to have a data system in place that you can improve your data sources, because of course you will, the first time you do this, you will miss some information that is not available, but this allows you to have some dialogue with other institutions that may have this information, so they may start collecting this data. So we think of it as a process, and over time, the idea is that you should improve the quality of this inventory. Okay, I didn't tell you, but in Montenegro, I mentioned 2015, we also did it for 2013. Okay, and emissions increased by more or less 10% in 2 years, which is a lot. Okay, something important as well is that the figure is relevant. It's good to know that you are, I think in Montenegro it was 600,000 tons of CO2. That's important, but what is really important is what you can do with it. Because once you know what are your emissions, you also know your energy sources, you also know where emissions come from, and you can start to share this information with the people who are managing these emissions. You can manage yourself, think about projects to improve your performance, energy efficiency, etc. You can reduce your emissions or maybe even offset your emissions, no? But just offsetting your emissions to become carbon neutral, if you don't have a good picture of where you are, probably doesn't make a lot of sense. The first step is to think about what you can do, no? In order to reduce your emissions. Of course, you are not alone, and in this case, not so many as someone would think, but there are lots of experiences in other places and in other countries and regions with some papers and reports calculating greenhouse gas emissions. So you can have a look on the internet. There are even some reviews that you may find in literature where you can see which countries have made this information available, but there are not a lot, but there are quite a few that you can use as a reference. And as I said, the report from Montenegro is available online. Okay, but also, and this is the last thing I wanted to say, you need to be careful, because sometimes we will be talking about apples and oranges. It's not so easy to compare. You cannot take the emissions from Montenegro and compare them with the emissions from Spain. As I said, the scope is different. In Montenegro it was broader, methodologies are different, emission factors are different, so you need to be very careful when comparing. So to me, having a greenhouse gas inventory is more for you to manage these emissions and to know how you can improve than just to compare it with another region or with another country. That's my view. Okay. And that's it. And I look forward, I don't know if there is time for any questions.